Bismillah, walhamdulillah, and Allah's mercy and blessings be upon all of His messengers and on us, our loved ones and our families. My dear sisters and my brothers, Assalaamu Alaikum warahmatullah. This is your brother Abdus Salam, and today we're coming up with the second installment about if the Qur'an by itself was an authority, then how did we learn how to pray? In this installment today, I will speak about each and every part of As-Salaat, the history behind it. I'm not going to speak about if it's Sunnah, it's not, and what, and no, I'm going to speak how it came and it became part of our Salaat, because understanding this will help us understand how Allah told us how to pray in Al-Quran. And these are called acts of As-Salaat. But before getting ahead and starting on the topic, I want to say this. One day, some over 1,441 years ago, as of 2020, a whole tribe that lived in the Arabian Peninsula, in Mecca exactly, wanted from a man who spent all his life with them, but who suddenly started preaching that he was a messenger of God to them. Quraysh was surprised. Few things they couldn't understand. How would Allah send a human being as an angel? And they heard that with the Jews and Christians and other stories, that before Allah used to send also angels. So how come Allah would just send a human being to them in the persona of Muhammad? They also asked him for miracles, and then the Prophet Muhammad did not provide or bring with him any miracles. So Quraysh did not understand, why doesn't Allah give him miracles as he gave to Moses, to Musa, to Isa, Jesus, or Dawood, David, or Solomon, Sulaiman, and all those messengers? Why doesn't Muhammad come up with a miracle? And then if they saw that miracle, they would believe. As a whole, they had so many whys in their heads, whys that would help them get their heads around this man who claims to be a messenger from God, the God of Abraham to them, a God to whom they have pilgrimaged so many years, and they have the Kaaba there, and Arabs would come from all around the country to pay their respect and make their Hajj to the Kaaba. This God who have taught them so many things. Yet this man has come today to tell them that the God is telling them that they got it all wrong, that they have built some new beliefs and concepts that were not at that time, that Allah did not approve at all. So Quraysh had tried so many different ways to bribe this man, this messenger, because they thought maybe he is not a messenger, maybe he's just after something. So they offered him to be a king over them, and he declined, and they offered him money, and he declined. So they started now dividing and asking and maybe coming up with new strategies to make this man work with them. So to stop this, what's in their opinion, a madness, they tried something new with this man who claims to be a messenger. And because he has grown with them in 40 years and they know him very well and he knows them very well, and they have bonds and ties and families and marriages and all those things, they went together through thick and thin in 40 years. So they come up with something to him that if he did, then they would respond and there would be a great deal of goodness from them to him to help him with his message. There is no one better to tell us about what they wanted than Allah Ta'ala. Allah says in Al-Quran, وَإِن كَادُوا لَيَفْتِنُونَكَ عَنِ الَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ. They, the disbelievers of Quraysh, tried to tempt you away from what we revealed to you, i.e. Quraysh was doing its utmost to turn away the Prophet or the Messenger of Allah Muhammad from the Qur'an that was revealed to him. In other ayat of the Qur'an, they told him, Ya Muhammad, change this, bring another Qur'an, we can't do this, bring a whole book, no, change this. So they wanted Prophet Muhammad to play in the text of the Qur'an so that it meets their likings. And once he did that, they would embrace Islam and become Muslims. What did the Prophet of Allah do? He did something extremely strange. Really, really extremely strange. And that is, He listened to Quraysh and was about to do exactly as they wanted. He nearly started playing in the Qur'an of Allah. It sounds to you strange, and you go, what? The Messenger of Allah doing that? Yes. But always know, my dear brothers and my sisters, the Muhammad, the Messenger that you know, is solely and only and individually based on the Hadith only. The Qur'an, you don't hear anything of these things. So Muhammad, when he was asked by Quraysh to play in the Qur'an, he nearly did it. And if he did it, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so that you would invent some other revelations and attribute that revelation to us, لِتَفْتَرِيَ عَلَيْنَا غَيْرَهُ. So I read the English, they, the disbelievers of Quraysh, tried to lure and tempt you, Ya Muhammad, away from what we have revealed to you, so that you would invent some other revelations and attribute those revelations to Allah. And what is the price for doing this? وَإِذًا لَتَّخَذُوكَ خَلِيلًا. And then they would have taken you as a means and a pathway to what they want. You become a close friend to theirs and ally to them. And then Allah tells him, وَلَوْلَا أَن ثَبَّتْنَاكَ. And had we not made you stand your ground by sending down the Qur'an, by supporting Prophet Muhammad with messages from Allah, the Qur'an and the messengers, the angels. So Allah was working against Quraysh on the messenger. And had we not made you stand your grounds, لَقَدْ كِتَّ تَرْكَنُوا إِلَيْهِمْ. You almost were about to lean towards them and obey them in what they asked you. And that is to invent something that is not part of the Qur'an and attribute it to Allah as if it was a revelation from Allah. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كِتَّ تَرْكَنُوا إِلَيْهِمْ. You almost were about to lean towards them, شَيْئًا قَلِيلًا, just a little. And then Allah threatens the Prophet Muhammad so that he never ever puts himself where he have to bargain on the words of Allah, the Qur'an. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells him, if you ever lean towards them, إِذًا لَأَذَقْنَاكَ ضِعْفَ الْحَيَاةِ, then we would have made you taste a double portion of punishment in this life. Allah would punish Muhammad twice, as he would punish anyone else. You take the worst punishment that can hit a human being on earth, Allah would punish the Prophet Muhammad twice that punishment in this life. وَضِعْفَ الْمَمَاتِ, and a double portion of punishment after death. On resurrection day, not only would he be punished the worst of punishment, but twice the punishment that the worst person on judgment day should get. And then Allah tells him, ثُمَّ لَا تَجِدُ لَكَ عَلَيْنَا نَصِيرًا. Then you would find none to help you against us. Where Quraysh failed, somebody else had succeeded. Somebody else has made the Prophet Muhammad utter words and then attribute those words to Allah as a revelation from Allah. And that is what you hear today, the Qudsi Hadith. The Hadith, the Sunnah, all those are texts. If Quraysh, if the messenger had them with Quraysh, they would have loved him. If Prophet Muhammad had the Quran and the Hadith and the Sunnah and the Qudsi Hadith, Quraysh would have loved him to bits, because that's exactly what they wanted. But as I said, somebody somewhere in the darkest of nights had succeeded in making Allah's messenger do exactly what Quraysh wanted, and that is say things from himself, then attribute them to Allah. And that's what they say, Hadith is a revelation from Allah. It is not a revelation from Allah, for Allah has only revealed the Quran and the Quran alone. That somebody knew very well that the only thing that the messenger's job was to do, and that is being a messenger, was just to deliver the message, and that's the Quran to mankind. Yet that somebody, that somewhere, that school of thought, that sheikh, that scholar, succeeded in taking us, the believers, away from the only means that would save us, not only in this life, but also in the hereafter. Something that Allah approved that it would serve as a savior. You see, my dear sisters and my brothers, mankind without any divine guidance is doomed to perdition, to loss, to a life of misery on earth and in the hereafter. If Allah had not forbidden the killing of lives and has made it that it is a big deal, and now if someone kills somebody, the police gets involved, the murder investigation goes around and things like that, killing would have been like as easy as cutting a flower from a garden. Without that, we humans become just animals. And this is why Allah in Al-Quran has given us what would serve to us to save us here and help us also save us from hellfire on Judgment Day. That thing is what Allah says in Ali Imran, that's the surah number 3, when He said, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ. When you go to the English translations, they always tell you, Allah says, hold on tight to the rope of Allah. Cling on tight to the rope of Allah. But this is not the translation of what Allah wants to say, because He said it in so many other ayat to follow what has been revealed in the Qur'an and the Qur'an alone. But what Allah says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا, just like He said it to the messenger, وَاللَّهُ يَعْصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ, and Allah will protect you, will shield you, will ensure that no harm shall get to you from people. Allah uses the same term, al-i'tisam, and uses it here for the Qur'an and the Qur'an alone. When He says, وَعَتَصِمُ, i.e. shield protectively yourselves with the rope of Allah. i.e. if you are in a battlefield and you have a shield that will protect you against your enemy's sword or arrows and things like that, Allah is commanding us to use the Qur'an as an element of shield to protect us. So, وَعَتَصِمُ بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ. Allah is not commanding us to hang on tight to the Qur'an, but rather to use, to hide ourselves behind the Qur'an. And then He goes, جَمِيعًا, all of you. وَلَا تَفَرَّقُوا, and do not divide. Do not divide from where? Do not divide yourselves from Al-Qur'an. Just like you give your soldier a bulletproof jacket or a shield or things like that, and you tell them, hide behind these shields, because if you do not, you will be killed. And do not divide from it. And division is when you run away from what is protective to you. And what's protective to us humans at spiritual level, and also as leading a better life here on earth, is running away from the Qur'an. Why am I saying all this, my dear sisters? Because as I am, brothers as well. Why? Because somewhere, as I said, somebody had managed to invent things in Al-Islam, attributed them to Rasulullah, and then they said that Rasulullah said them because He attributes them to Allah. And here we are in the contradictions we live, that Allah has threatened the messenger, if he ever invented anything other than the Qur'an, Allah would punish him, would do this. And here we are today, we live on an Islam that has been solely, totally invented on anything but the Qur'an itself. And this is what's leading us today to speak about the Salah that we perform. What makes the Salah? Why do we keep saying Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar? Why do we say that? You think it's a Sunnah, right? When you raise your hands and you say Allahu Akbar, why do you start your Salat with Allahu Akbar and not with other terminologies? Why don't we say, for example, Subhanallah or Alhamdulillah? And why do we end our Salat with Assalaamu Alaikum and not with Alhamdulillah, since we just finished doing an act of ritual? Shouldn't be thankful at the end of it? I believe that by saying Alhamdulillah is more appropriate than saying Assalaamu Alaikum. Who are you saying peace on you? You just finished praying. Who are you declaring war on? Or who are you telling, oh, don't fear war from me. I'm just saying, Assalamu Alaikum. In this second installment of how we learned how to pray from the Qur'an, and also there is a small warning that I want to say at this moment here. If you haven't listened to the first installment, please, please do so before you embark on this second installment. Otherwise, many of the things that I will mention here and also in the upcoming two installments when I speak about the Al-Isra and Al-Mi'raj journey and then how the Qur'an, and then on the fourth installment, I will tell you how the Qur'an taught us how to pray. Because if you don't listen to installment one and then you build on any two and three and four, many of the things that I will say later on will not make much sense to you and will just confuse you. And instead of providing you with a solution, you end up more confused. And that's extremely important because in this series, I am building knowledge one on top of other. As-salat, my dear sisters and my brothers. What is as-salah when you look at it? I'm not speaking about the meaning in Arabic, which states for relationship and also making a good supplication for somebody. But as-salat, the act itself. When you make your wudu and you go face the qibla and you start doing your salat. What is that? As-salat, in its simplest of explanation, is a spiritual meeting with Allah. If you will, Salat is a relationship protocol between the believer and his Lord. We bow, we put our head on the floor, and we say what we say, and we do what we do, and all those things, these are part of a big protocol. And anyone who believes in Allah was given a protocol, a way, a form on how to do things to speak to Allah. I mean anyone who believes in Allah, be them Jews, be them Christian, be they or us or Hindu, Sikh, anyone that who they pray to is their God, then that whatever they do is the protocol that they use to communicate with Allah. Please keep this description with you as it will serve us throughout this installment. When you look at the definition of the term protocol in international treaties, they tell you it's the official procedure or system of rules governing affairs or state or diplomatic occasions, meaning when a president goes to visits another country, the other country do not need to agree with what we do, because they have a protocol, and that protocol is known by everybody. When the other president gets there, he knows what should be done, and the other people know what should be done. Basically, as I said, so when we go and speak to Allah, Allah has set the protocol with which He wants us to speak to Him. So He says, okay, if you want to talk to me, and I'm talking about the believers, and the Jews have their protocol, the Christians have their protocol, we the believers have our protocol. Our protocol has A, we should turn to the Qibla, 2, we should make wudu, 3, we should have the time, and things like that, and then we should go and pray to Allah and speak to Him. So when it comes to as-salat, then, as I said one more time, it's a protocol designed by Allah on how He wants His believing subservience, which is you and me, to address and communicate with Him. And because of this only, the only one to decide how this protocol should run is Allah. And this brings me to say that nobody has any right to add to the Salat protocol or even have a say in what goes into it, because it's a protocol designed by Allah, okay, or how it's done and things like that. And this means also not angels, not messengers, not sheikhs, not scholars, no men of religion. Nobody has any right to say how this protocol should run except one, and that one is Allah. This will become evident as we progress in this subject, my dear sisters. So bear with me, because a lot of things that I will explain to you will really, really, really shock you. You will raise your eyebrows, you go, really? Oh, I didn't know. And you will have lots of those moments there. And that's because how Allah designed as-salat and how we perform it are two different words. Not entirely, but so many things really will have you think like 600 times more. To kickstart this second installment, let us ask few questions. And each time I ask the question, I'd like you to answer it. I'm going to ask you a few questions and I want you to answer, please. Either it's a yes or no type of questions. Okay, so nothing more. So let me start with the first of the seven simple questions. Would Allah take any advice from any other than himself on how he would run this world? Does Allah check with humans on how he should run this world? Yes? No? Question number two. Did Allah consult with any other than himself he would put in this Quran? The topics, the surah, the verses, things like that? Question number three. Would Allah take any advice from any other than himself on how he will run Judgment Day? And this is very one for the Judgment Day. It's extremely, extremely important on this particular one. And I'll tell you why. Because for the Jews believe, and they call it like the Arabic-speaking people, Yawm al-Din, the day of Deen, the day of accountability. They say that that day will occur after the coming of the Messiah. And the when he comes to this world, the Messiah, what they say is, they believe that Allah, on Judgment Day, both of him and the Messiah, shall judge people on that day. And whoever believed in the Messiah the way the Jewish people believe, shall receive exceptional well and great treatment and shall be exempted from many things, hellfire. And if that Jewish person who believed in the Messiah was to enter hellfire after all, he would spend 7 days. That's all. That's so. For the Jews, it's the Messiah hand in hand with Allah who will rule over the day of judgment, and your admission to paradise will depend on your belief in the Messiah or none of it. Comes the Christian. The Christian have the same thing, and that is Jesus. They say he will sit by the right side of his Father, and then he will, along with his Father, judge on people. Whoever believes in Jesus, then he will enter paradise, receive special treatments. Well, even if they enter hellfire, he won't spend much time because Jesus will save him because. Guess what? We, the believers, did exactly the same thing. They will tell you that the Prophet Muhammad on Judgment Day, when everybody is scared, except Muhammad will come, Ummati, Ummati, my nation, and then Allah would tell him, Ya Muhammad, raise, because they tell you Muhammad goes and prostrates in front of the Arsh. They make you believe that Allah is sitting on a throne and Muhammad is prostrating at his feet, making his dua for a long time. And then Allah tells you, Muhammad, raise and ask and you shall be given. And Muhammad will say, Ummati, Ummati, my nation. And then Allah tells him, Ya Muhammad, ask and we'll give you. We're not going to deceive you. And then, of course, Muhammad will have the biggest chunk of humans enter paradise. And Muhammad will boast in front of the other messengers. Look at me. Look at my followers. You see, I'm better than you. That kind of attitude. And this all is wrong. This is not what the Quran says. Don't we recite in Al-Fatiha that Allah is Malik Yawm al-Din, is the king, is the owner of Judgment Day? Hasn't Allah in a plethora of ayat said that only Allah is the judge on Judgment Day? That Allah is the only one who decides who will enter to Jannah and Paradise? That Allah is, but no! No! The Jews have put the Messiah, not even Musa there. The Christians have made Jesus, and we made Muhammad the biggest of them all. And of course, all these are lies. So I hope to Allah, then for the first previous four questions, you've answered no. Then let us go to question number four. Did Allah consult with any other than himself on how he would create this world? I mean, he disguised the billions upon billions of galaxies, atoms of oxygen, humans, animals, trees, plants, and things like that. Did Allah do that? Of course not. Number five, did Allah consult with anybody on who to appoint as the angel of death? Did Allah make research? Okay, who is fit for this job? Of course not. He just appointed one angel and he became the angel of death. So the answer is no. Question number 6. Would Allah take any advice from any other than Himself on how He designs and creates Jannah? When He creates it, when He creates the new world, the new earth, the new heavens and everything, only then will He create Jannah. Jannah doesn't exist today. But when He creates it, is He going to ask people, what do you think? What do you think should I put in Jannah? Yeah, you the angels, what should I put? Of course not. He's going to do it by Himself. And the same thing for question number 7. Would Allah take any advice from any other than Himself on how He designs and creates hellfire? And the answer is no. And I hope to Allah you've answered no to all the aforementioned questions, because that is the correct answer. Allah takes no advice from anybody. Anybody, be that Jibril, which is the closest spirit to the highest prophet, messenger, whatever. All of them, as Allah says in the Quran, that all of them will come on judgment day to Allah as subservient. That's all. But what can we say? The hadith tells us different. Would Allah, my dear sisters and my brothers, take any advice from any other than Himself on who how he should design Islam, what he should put in his Islam, what should he make halal and haram? The answer is no. Would Allah consult with any other on what salat, what should be in the salat or what shouldn't be in the salat? Of course not. We can't say, oh yes, the Prophet Muhammad had sunnah. Of course not. Prophet Muhammad is just a human who executes what Allah wants. That's it. And when the Prophet Muhammad died, he didn't leave any book written with his actions. And as I said in number 1, if you have written your will and you die and then someone adds on your will after your death, it's not you who has written it. It's somebody else who has added. And since Prophet Muhammad died and no hadith, nothing was approved by himself or written, then except the Quran, then anything that comes after him is, guess what? Not approved, not by him and not by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. My dear sisters and my brothers, this salat should be exactly how Allah wants it. And how he wants it is in the Quran. It's not elsewhere. As I said, Allah is not going to teach us how to make wudu and abandon us for salat. It just doesn't make sense. My sisters and my brothers, bear this truth that I'm going to mention right now, and you will be doing fine, and you will meet Allah in the best of terms. Messengers, prophets, are only messengers. They are not legislators. Anyone who tells you that a messenger is a legislator is a lying. Yes, they will bring some ayat and they will tell you obey Allah and obey the messenger and do this. But as is always the case, it's open to interpretations and they interpret it like that, but they do not interpret it as Allah wants it to be interpreted. Allah, my dear sisters and my brothers, only sends messengers with His message. After all, that's why they called messengers, right? Because they are sent. I'm sending you a messenger. A code, an international code that says messengers should never be killed. And they unquestionably and unequivocally deliver Allah's message as trusted. Because if a messenger doesn't do the job properly, they will get a warning and they will get a threat from Allah. Listen to this. Allah addressing His messenger, Muhammad. Ya ayyuha rasul. Hey you, messenger. Balligh ma unzila ilayka min rabbik. Broadcast what has been descended to you from your Lord. At the time of Prophet Muhammad, the messenger Muhammad, people didn't read or write, so it was not about, and there was no internet, and there was no emails. So the only way for people to know what Allah has descended was for the messenger to do what? To read it out to people. And that's exactly what the messenger did. One of the jobs that the messenger did that a lot of nobody almost talks about it is to sit where people can hear him and he would read the Qur'an. He would sit there and just read the Qur'an. And people are free to sit down, listen, pass by, listen, and do all kinds of stuff. That's one thing they never ever speak about, and that's something that the messenger did a lot, and that is he sits down and just recites the Qur'an. You see, they make the Rasulullah just recite the Qur'an in Salat, and that's that. But that's wrong, because Allah tells him, broadcast what has been descended to you from your Lord. وَإِن لَمْ تَفَعَلْ And if you don't broadcast, if you don't read to people, then فَمَا بَلَّغْتَ رِسَالَتَهُ Then you have not delivered the message of Allah. In other words, it's all or nothing. And since Allah is commanding the messenger to broadcast and convey Allah's Qur'an to all kinds and types of people, and people are different. You have the kind, you have the rude, you have the violent, you have the savage, you have the disturbed, you have the maniac, you have the drunk, you have the drugged, you have the horrible, terrible, miserable, you have all these kinds of people, right? Well, this is much of what the messenger is supposed to do. He is supposed to read to them, broadcast to them the Qur'an. If he doesn't broadcast the Qur'an to people, Allah tells him, you have not delivered Allah's message. In the old days, when the king issues a decree, who would he give it to? He had a team of people that would go to the market, would beat the drums to attract the attention of people, and then the person would broadcast the decree to people of what the king wanted. And this is exactly what Allah says to the messenger, you go out there and read to people, broadcast to them the Quran of Allah. And because people, as I said, there is the rude, there is the violent, the savage, the disturbed, the maniac, the assassin, and all kinds of stuff, Allah gives a guarantee to the messenger, and he tells him, وَاللَّهُ يَعَصِمُكَ مِنَ النَّاسِ And Allah shall insinuate you, shall secure you, shall shield you away from people. Just like he says, وَاعْتَصِمُوا بِحَبْلِ اللَّهِ Insinuate, secure, shield yourselves with the Qur'an. Here it's Allah who insinuates, secures and shields the Prophet Muhammad and his messenger away from the rude, the violent, the savage, the disturbed, the maniac, the assassin, so that Muhammad can broadcast the Quran without being scared of Quraysh and all those crazy people's retaliation. And then Allah says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَهْدِي For Allah does not guide الْقَوْمَ الْكَافِرِينَ The people who deliberately disbelief. And this is mentioned again in Surah Al-Ma'idah. And as I said, Al-Ma'idah was revealed in the last 90 days of the life of the Prophet Muhammad. And he did what he did, and he recited, broadcast the Quran to people. My dear sisters and my brothers, there is a huge difference between Muhammad the Messenger and Muhammad the Prophet. And there are some incidents that happened in Al-Quran. There are tons of ayahs that talk about events where the Prophet Muhammad made mistakes and where Allah corrected those mistakes, but not the messenger, because the messenger has no control over what gets to him. The Prophet Muhammad is talking to people. One time Allah wants to send a message. The Prophet Muhammad knows it's the message, but the people know, and then suddenly something happens to the messenger. Then when he talks, people know from the way he talks, what he talks, that is Allah talking, not the messenger talking. And that's why Allah in Surah Al-Najm, when he says, وَمَا يَنْتَقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى He does not utter out of himself, and Allah is talking about the Qur'an. One day, my dear sisters and my brothers, Allah's messenger, the Prophet Muhammad, was in a battle. After the battle finished, and that is Badr, after it ended, and the Muslims had captivated many non-believers. It did not really fully end, but most of it, they captivated some prisoners of war, some leaders of Mecca, and things like that. So the Prophet held a meeting to decide what to do with these captives of war. Then him and his companions made the wrong choice. And as soon as they decided to ransom the people that wanted to kill them, what they did is they wanted to ransom them, take money against them. And speedily did Jibril came down, and Jibril came down with this blood-frozen threat from Allah, a huge warning from Allah that Allah is absolutely displeased with what the Prophet and his friends had come up to, has concluded. Here's what Allah says. مَا كَانَ لِلنَّبِيِّ It is not fit for the Prophet, for this Prophet. It's not fit for a Prophet. أَن يَكُونَ لَهُ أَسْرَى That he should take captives. حَتَّى يُثْخِنَ فِي الْأَرْضِ Until he has thoroughly subdued the land. You are in a battle against Quraysh. Carry on the battle. They here to kill you. Why did you settle? As soon as you got few captives, you asked for money? Is this what you stand for? And as you know, the Battle of Badr took place in the second year after the Hijrah in Al-Madinah, and the Muslims went there. So my dear sisters, when the Muslims had opted to captive people and ransom them, that did not sit well with Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. And then Allah blows the cover of His Prophet and the people with Him. Allah says, تُرِيدُونَ عَرَضَ الدُّنْيَا Do you wish for what life offers by ransoming? Wallahu yuridu al-akhirah and Allah wants for you the hereafter. Wallahu azizun hakim and Allah is mighty and very regulated. Lawla kitabun min Allah sabaq. Had it not because of a previous law that Allah put on Himself. What is that law that Allah shall punish on Judgment Day? For the people that came after Muhammad, we don't get annihilated on earth. So Allah has put this rule and is following it. And were it not because of this rule, لَمَسَّكُمْ فِيمَا أَخَذْتُمْ You would have been disciplined because of what you took, the ransom that they took. عَذَابٌ عَظِيمٌ A very tremendous punishment. And when Allah says tremendous, we should understand the tremendous from Allah's view, not from my view or your view. And this is extremely important because you don't joke. Nobody jokes with Allah. Prophet or not, Prophet Muhammad knew better as to not prioritize this life over the hereafter. And instead of asking Allah, instead of waiting on Allah what to do with the situation, he went ahead and did as he pleased. And Allah did not accept that from him. My dear sisters and my brothers, Allah is a God that lives in the present. He is here. If you fight Allah, Allah fights you. But Allah doesn't enter in a direct war with you. He's a God and we are just a human being. But what Allah does is He uses what exists on earth to fight these people. My dear sisters, those threatening ayat came at a time when the believers were weak and in constant danger from Quraysh. And the threats of Quraysh were abandoned. And the Arabs were just watching where Quraysh gets up to. And then the Arabs would themselves also take sides, either with Quraysh, if they win, or just keep away from Muhammad. But later on, when Muslims became strong and they became powerful and became... Allah Tabaraka Ta'ala changed this rule. And He said in Surah Muhammad, that is Surah number 47, this is ayah 4, فَإِمَّا And He's speaking about the war here, and you've got captives of war. He says, فَإِمَّا مَنَّا بَعْدْ وَإِمَّا فِدَاءً Then you choose, once you have captives, either as a favor to these captives, you release them, or you receive a ransom for them. When you are powerful, subhanAllah, you set a prisoner of war for free. Or you ask for a ransom, entirely up to you. As opposed to when they were weak, they had no right in taking a decision out of themselves. Prophet or not a prophet. And books of history say that the Prophet cried a lot and his companions, and they were absolutely scared of Allah. Another example. When in Surah Al-Ahzab, and that's Surah number 33, in the first ayah you open the Surah, Allah starts with a chilling threat to Muhammad. He tells him, Ya ayyuhan nabi, you the prophet, ittaqillah, safeguard yourself from Allah's punishment. وَلَا تُطِعِ الْكَافِرِينَ وَالْمُنَافِقِينَ, and do not obey the non-believers and the hypocrites. Why would Allah threaten His messenger like this? Why would Allah threaten the prophet like this? Because the messenger has no right, he delivers. But the prophet is the human being that follows the Qur'an. Allah says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّبِي, you the prophet, I'm talking to you, Muhammad, اتَّقِ اللَّهِ. And when Allah says it, it means what the Prophet did at that time was not taqwa of Allah. What he did was purely evil at that moment there. So Allah puts him back in his own place and he says, ittaqillah wa la tuti'il kafirin. So what he has done, he obeyed again the disbelievers and the hypocrites. In Surah Al-Fath, Allah tells the messenger that he has forbidden all his sins, the past ones and the one he would commit in the future. Had Allah not forgiven the messenger's sins and all bad actions, our messengers, just like you and me, would stand in front of Allah full accountability. But for this one, he has had a good deal. So well done for him. The third example, and I'll stop here because there are so many examples in the Quran. Allah says now, Ya ayyuhan nabi, one more time, speaking to the prophet. And the Prophet has made a big, huge mistake. And Allah again corrects him, puts him there to his place. لِمَ تُحَرِّمُ مَا أَحَلَّ اللَّهُ لَكَ. Why do you make haram what Allah has made halal for you? And this is a famous story. It's in the Quran, in Surah Al-Tahrim 66 and the ayah number 1. And you read from ayah 1 until 8 or 9. Why did he do that? تَبْتَغِي مَرْضَاتَ أَزْوَاجِكَ, desiring your wife's approval. Because as the story goes, that the Messenger of Allah used to love drinking milk, and for a small incident, then he said, I will not drink milk at all, and he prohibited it on himself. But it's not up to him to do that. It's not up to him to behave in a manner that Allah didn't give him order to. So Allah again uses the same thing. Ya ayyuhan nabi, you're the prophet. Why do you make haram on you what Allah has made halal for you? Are you seeking your wife's approval? And then Allah says, Wallahu ghafurun rahim. And Allah is very forgiving and very merciful. Why? Because you've committed a sin. But Allah will forgive it to you because He is merciful. Prophets do not have the right to contradict the message they receive from Allah. They do not mix their views or practices or understandings with what comes from Allah. This is why when the Prophet Muhammad did things that Allah disapproved of, Allah straight away puts him back on track. Notice again, one more time, that I said when Prophet Muhammad did this and Allah doesn't approve of it, and I didn't say when the Messenger of Allah did things. Because if the Messenger, as a Messenger, did something that Allah doesn't approve of, it's death for him. Because he become a kafir. Yes, Prophet Muhammad, Messenger Muhammad, would become a kafir. If Allah reveals the Quran to him, and the messenger changes what has been revealed to him, he will have the spiritual treatment of disbelief, but also a physical. Look to what Allah says about this. Why? You know why I'm telling you all this? Because the Quran has to come back to the driving force, and that it's impossible for Prophet Muhammad or Messenger Muhammad to add to Allah's religion. Because later on, when I mention to you the different parts that were added to a Salat and what the Quran says about that, you're going to find out that what the Quran, the Salat in the Quran, is absolutely beautiful. Absolutely nice, absolutely simple, absolutely easy, and absolutely would not drive you mad when you don't feel like you wanna pray. Look to what Allah says. The owner of the Quran says about if the messenger ever added one little tiny squeezy mini word in Al-Quran or other than Al-Quran, then say it's from Allah. Allah says, إِنَّهُ أَيْءِ الْقُرْآنِ لَقَوْلُ رَسُولٍ كَرِيمٍ. It, the Qur'an, surely is indeed the narrative of an honorable messenger. He just narrates it. It doesn't come from him. He just narrates it. And then Allah says, وَمَا هُوَ الْقُرْآنِ بِقَوْلِ شَاعِرٍ قَلِيلًا مَا تُؤْمِنُونَ. And it, i.e. the Qur'an, is not the prose of a poet, as you claim. Quraysh said that, he's a poet. And then Allah says, how little you believe. You can see it's not, Muhammad cannot do that. وَلَا هُوَ, i.e. the Qur'an, بِقَوْلِ كَاهِنٍ قَلِيلًا مَا تَذَكَّرُونَ. Nor it is the Qur'an, the word of a high priest. How little do you recall? Muhammad has never worked as a high priest, as a pretentious soothsayer or magician or someone who will just mumble words. He's never done that. And because Quraysh know the life of Muhammad, so when they made these claims, they really lost the ability to recall things. Otherwise, they would never ever have made such an unrealistic claims of being a poet and a high priest in a temple and things like that. Then once Allah nullified their empty claims and attacked them and showed them that they were really nothing, He described who Muhammad was and what his position vis-a-vis of the Quran was, and that the two were totally separate. The Quran is not Muhammad. Muhammad is not the Quran. The Quran is the word of Allah. Muhammad is the messenger that Allah transmits through him, the Quran. Think of the messenger Muhammad as your phone. I call you to speak to you, but I use my phone to get through to your phone so you can hear me. So my phone and your phone are only messengers that deliver our messages. That's exactly a good comparison. But now Allah tells us what the Quran is. He says, Tanzilun, i.e. this Quran is a tanzil, a message descended min Rabbil Alameen, from the Lord of the worlds. Comes a threat to Muhammad, and Quraysh hear this, and it should send some shivers down your spine, just like it did theirs. وَلَوْ تَقَوَّلَ عَلَيْنَا مِنْ غَيْرِ الْقُرْآنِ بِبَعْضِ الْأَقَاوِيلِ. And if Muhammad ever made up about us in addition to the Quran some sayings, he added, oh, it's Sunnah, it's Hadith to do this, it's Sunnah to do that, it's this. If he ever added anything besides the Quran, لَأَخَذْنَا مِنْهُ بِالْيَمِينِ, we would have certainly seized him by his right hand, by his right side. Why seize him by the right side? Because people believe before would hold the sword with the right hand, and if your right hand is tied, then you are vulnerable. You can lose easily in a fight. So Allah is saying, so that Muhammad cannot even defend himself, will hold him from the right hand. And then what's going to happen to him once he's done that? Allah says, ثُمَّ لَقَطَعْنَا مِنْهُ الْوَتِينَ. Then we would have severed his aorta. Imagine someone super strong who holds you from your right and then with the other hand grabs your neck, digs their strong fingers into your throat and pulls your aorta out. The victim would fall dead right there and then. The blood line has been severed, has been very, very, very indeed damaged. The picture is very disturbing, but Allah is even more serious about the relationship between the messenger and Allah's religion found in the Quran. Would the tribe of Quraysh be able to defend Prophet Muhammad? No. If he went and leaned towards them and became like them and started adding on top of the Quran, when Allah decides to punish him, Quraysh cannot and will not. And that's why Allah tells them ahead of time, فَمَا مِنْكُمْ مِنْ أَحَدٍ عَنْهُ حَاجِزِينَ. And none of you could ever defend him. وَإِنَّهُ and i.e. and this Qur'an لَتَذْكِرَةٌ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ is a reminder to the muttaqeen, to the pious and godly people. To sum it up, my dear sisters and my brothers, the Prophet can never ever add to Allah's Islam. He simply is there, he practices the Qur'an that has been revealed to him, and the messenger can never ever add to Allah's Islam. He simply has no authority and is simply delivering what Allah has mentioned. Now that we have established the difference between the Prophet, Muhammad the Prophet, and Muhammad the Messenger, let us delve deeper in the Salat that we are doing today. How did Allah's Messenger learn how to pray? In the books of jurisprudence, in the fiqh, which deal with Salat and the other topics like wudu, hajj, salat, all those things is called fiqh, i.e. it's the deeper understanding of issues. All right? They say that in Islam, a Salat developed through several stages, and the shape it is on has been modified many times over. What they are saying is this: the Salat that is with us today is the complete one. But it was not always like this. It had gone through stages of changes, stages of changes, stages of changes. And I'm talking here from in Islam, not with Musa and Isa. I'm just talking in our Islam, and that the Salat went through so many different stages and changes until it got to us how it is today. They also say that the number of rak'at was increased after the Prophet Muhammad migrated to Al-Madinah. However, and I say, and I will introduce this, I will say something, what they say, and then I will say, and I say, my point of view in this. With such a very important ritual, a Salat, we don't have the exact date for when the number of rak'at in our Salat increased. Yet, when the Qibla had changed, which in comparison to a Salat is much lesser topic, it's the value of the Qibla to a Salat is less than the Salat itself. Yet, every sheikh, every scholar, every student of knowledge, all of them know exactly when the Qibla changed, and how it changed, and where what people were doing when it changed. You ask any of them, they will tell you, oh, the Qibla changed 16 months after the migration. So for 16 months, they prayed, as they said, to Jerusalem, and then Allah changed the Qibla to Baytullah al-Haram, to Mecca today. So the thing is, we know when we change direction, but we don't know when the number of rak'at increased. Fajr was 2, and then it became 4. Fajr was 2, it meant 4, but Dhuhr, according to them, was 2, and then it became 4. Asr was 2, and then it became 4. Maghrib was 2, and then it became 3. Isha was 2, and then it became 4. But when we ask them, when you do a search, when did As-Salat increase? They will tell you, oh, when the Prophet migrated to Al-Madinah, and that's that. Anything else than that, we do not know. Okay, I'm coming up to the hour here. I will stop at this point here, and inshallah, we'll pick up on part 2. And we are going to start with the loud and quiet Salat. Why do we recite Quran loudly in Fajr, Maghrib, and Isha, at least the first 2 rak'at? But when it comes to Dhuhr, Asr, and 1 rak'at of Maghrib, and the 2 last rak'at of Isha, we do them quietly. Why? But this is what we shall know in the upcoming or the next one talk, inshallah. Again, this is your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa, and up to the part 2. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah.